First, thank you all very much for attending this year's Camp IPPS. We hope that you are ready for all the knowledge and information that we are going to be providing in this course. My name is Ryan Silva, and I'm a travel and expense specialist. Joining us is my colleague, Josh Wheeler, who is also a travel and expense specialist. With travel picking back up to almost pre-pandemic levels, we have compiled some tips and tricks to successfully navigate the world of UC San Diego business travel. A great many of us have not traveled in quite some time, so this presentation will familiarize you with general travel policy. With the information we provide, traveling for university business will hopefully be streamlined and reconciling your travel expenses even easier. At the end of the presentation, we will be taking some questions you may have on travel policy and Concur reconciliation. Please post your questions in the chat. We invite you to visit our office hours we host 3 times a week for specific questions related to your expense reports and travel scenarios. Please note that this presentation is being recorded and will be emailed to you. You will have access to all the hyperlinks that we are included in this presentation. For those of you who are new in your roles and are required to process expenses on behalf of others or yourself, we have several training options available. We hold 3 VILTs for campus clients. They are events, travel before you go, travel reporting expenses. You can locate the training courses provided via Blink by searching training courses. There you can register for these trainings through UC Path or by using the UC Learning registration. We also have great training resources available via our KBAs. The KBAs provide great step-by-step guidance along with videos on processes. We have a large number of KBAs on various processes. These can be accessed via services support by searching for KBAs. If you need assistance with a specific process, you can search for keywords under the budget and finance knowledge base. This will pull up several KBAs, which may be helpful for the process that you're trying to do. The KBAs also provide details on policy, which help guide you on procedure, what you're trying to accomplish. We've included a couple hyperlinks to our most frequently asked questions. Using the Blink travel pages, you can access policy details. Within Blink, you can also search for Concur Basics, where it will help guidance on how to use Concur. Within Blink, you will be able to locate policy on the use of the T&E card, as well as guidance on how to apply for a T&E card. If you joined us for Kelsey Moon's Concur class, she mentioned that Concur is the only official booking method for all UCSD business travel. The Concur platform is where you have access to the university's negotiated contracts with airlines, hotels, and rental cars. Using Concur will allow you to avoid critical policy violations and ensure timely reimbursement to the travelers. Travelers should avoid booking these services outside of Concur, as we cannot guarantee complete reimbursement. With Concur, you have a travel agency to back you up. I even use it for my own personal travel, which you can do as well. That course is also available during Camp IPPS. We've created helpful reminders within Concur when booking and reconciling to keep you within guidelines of the university and the G28 travel policy. And now I'm going to pass it on to my colleague, Josh, who will talk more about G28 policy basics. The G28 policy is set forth by UCOP and governs travel as it's related to official university business.
Thank you, Ryan. Hello, everybody. I'm Josh, and once again, thank you for joining us today. The table on this slide shows the entire process from requesting and planning travel, going on your trip, to returning and reconciling your report, but we'll address more of these points later. Before you begin booking, a travel request should be submitted to your department's financial unit approver, outlining the trip details and estimated costs of the trip. These numbers do not need to be exact as they're only rough estimate of what's expected to be incurred on the trip. Once this is approved, you'll be able to book travel Concur using the approved request number. The business purpose of a university traveler may include activities that contribute to any one of the university's major functions of teaching, research, patient care, public service, or to any other substantial and bona fide university business activity. Please ensure that you provide all necessary details regarding the reason for the traveler's business. Some examples of a weak business purpose would be something along the lines of just attending a conference or field supplies, whereas something along the lines of attending the ABC conference as a subcontractor under UCSD XYZ grant, or traveling to a remote location where we'll need to pay people in cash for ABC supplies would be examples of a strong business purpose. The maximum amount authorized for daily meals and incidental expenses established by the university for all travel of less than 30 days is in the continental United States is $62. Travelers may seek reimbursement only for their actual expenses up to the cap amount. There is no exception to exceeding this daily maximum. Groceries are acceptable as long as the date range is indicated and does not exceed daily maximums. Group meals are allowable for group trips of those of three or more travelers. The group travelers must still abide by the $62 daily maximum per person. An incidental expense includes items such as tips and fees for services, like waiters and baggage handlers, and is included in the same $62 daily maximum. If you look at the right side of the slide, we have provided an example table of what a day of meals and incidentals might look like for you and where things could go wrong if you're not careful. Because meals and incidentals fall under the same maximum, it is possible to overlook how additional fees like tips can offset your total. Looking at our example, we can see that the daily total spent was $66, which is $4 more than what is allowable under policy. When you look a little deeper, we can see that $58 was spent on meals and $8 went to incidentals that day. In situations like this, the traveler cannot claim the overage for reimbursement or try to claim it on another day. The maximum amount authorized for daily lodging expenses established by the university is $275 before taxes and mandatory hotel fees, and must be supported by original itemized receipts, regardless of the amounts incurred, and must be reasonable for the locality of travel. The traveler is unable to secure lodging. When a traveler is unable to secure lodging at $275 per night or less, the traveler must submit additional documentation, such as price comparisons within the proximity of the meeting location that supports the higher lodging rate incurred. The price comparison should be gathered at the time of booking, as this will result in the most accurate comparable, given that travel expenses fluctuate so often. A traveler who is required to attend a conference where the prearranged conference lodging rate exceeds the $275 per night cap may stay at the conference hotel with supporting documentation that the lodging is associated with the conference. When attaching documentation to your expense report, we're looking for clear and compelling evidence. Ensure that you only upload the receipts and documents associated with the expense line that you are uploading them to. Please do not upload multi-page documents containing information meant for the entire expense report to every expense line, as this causes confusion with repeating duplicate documents showing up on our end while we're auditing your report. Coach, economy, or any discounted class shall be used in the interests of cost efficiency. This policy applies to all travel, whether it be domestic, foreign, or any combination thereof, regardless of the purpose or fund source. If advanced approval has been attained, a traveler may use surface transportation for personal reasons, even though air travel is the most appropriate mode of transportation. The most appropriate mode of transportation is set forth by the UCOP. The costs of meals, lodging, parking, mileage, tolls, taxis, and ferries incurred while in transit by surface transportation may be reimbursed. However, such costs shall not exceed the cost of airfare based on the lower of the regular coach fare available for the location of travel from a standard commercial air carrier or the campus travel program fare, plus transportation costs to and from the terminals. Use of business or first class may be authorized under certain circumstances. Documentation of such circumstances must be provided on the travel expense claim prior to submitting the expense report. Here are a few examples of some authorized circumstances. Business or first class is the only service offered between two points, or when the use of coach class would be more expensive or time consuming, like when, because of scheduling difficulties, traveling by air coach would require an unnecessary hotel expense or an unduly long layover when making connections. Itineraries involving overnight travel without an opportunity for normal rest before the commencement of working hours are also acceptable with appropriate documentation to support the early meeting time and or that the alternative start dates or times are unavailable. Last, when the use of business or first class travel is necessary to reasonably accommodate a disability or medical need of a traveler. When attaching the traveler's signed medical note to the report, please ensure that any sensitive information regarding the traveler's diagnosis is redacted and the necessary accommodations are stated. When a traveler prefers to use a higher class than the one authorized for reimbursement, the traveler must pay the incremental cost of the airfare. In cases other than those described above, a written authorization to use business or first class shall be obtained in advance by submitting a services and support case to ensure that it goes through the proper approval flow. Please reference the services and support case regarding the exception in the expense report before submission. A request for exception should not be made in the report itself. I'm now going to pass this presentation back to my colleague, Ryan, who will talk more about group transportation, required receipts, and foreign travel.
Thank you, Josh. As Josh mentioned in the previous slide, air travel is the preferred method of transportation. However, there are other ground transportation options available to the traveler. I've included a hyperlink to policy in Blink for mileage. Basically, travelers can claim mileage when using their personal vehicle for any official university-related business that takes them away from their headquarters. This also means that mileage cannot be claimed from the traveler's home to their assigned headquarters, as that is considered their normal commute. Since a majority of us now have hybrid remote schedules, our working from home days are considered headquarters. Please note that any mileage from home to headquarters is not reimbursable for mileage. Some common examples we see for mileage claims are traveling to offsite work locations for work-related business. During the pandemic, for example, we reviewed a lot of expense reports where we saw traveling nurses delivering vaccines. Another reason is attending a local conference. And by local, we generally accept the Southern California region without the need of comparable airfare. And if you are a researcher out in the field or a delegate of a researcher using a personal car to transport field equipment, Concur will automatically calculate mileage for you, but please be aware that rates have changed. Any mileage claimed in 2021 is at a rate of 56 cents a mile. From January through June of 2022, the mileage rate is 58.5 cents a mile. We now have a new mileage rate, hopefully to keep up with inflation, of July at 62.5 cents a mile. At times, we see the expense type of rental car fuel being claimed for personal car. Please note that gas is already factored into the mileage rate, as well as car wear and tear. Usually, travelers will receive more reimbursement when correctly claiming mileage compared to only gas. We will now move on to rental cars and fuel. Travelers should consider the most economical options when they've reached their destination. It may be in the department's financial interest to book a rental car for travelers, depending on the location of travel and duration. Ride shares can definitely add up, especially in places like Denver or Pittsburgh, where the airports are far away from the city center where most conferences are held. It may also make sense to reserve a rental car for local Southern California meetings or conferences like LA or Santa Barbara. Please note that we do consider, as Josh mentioned in the previous slide, the cost of flying than having to rent a car. So just make sure that the travelers are choosing the most logical and economical mode of transit. For any travel outside the Southern California region, for example, San Diego to San Jose, with a rental car, we would require comparable airfare. And this goes for personal mileage claims as well. Now that we've addressed the appropriate business situations for a rental car, I'm going to mention some specific policy points. We can only reimburse up to the intermediate car class unless there is a no-cost upgrade. We will require a business purpose if a higher class was chosen. The CDW/LDW per policy additional insurance for rental cars is not reimbursable. When additional insurance is purchased, you must contact risk management in order to obtain information on trip insurances. They are equipped to give you information on what is being covered and offer clarification on your questions. We've included a hyperlink below for that information. When we audit a report, We are required to review a rental car receipt, which notes the traveler's name, date of checkout slash in, car class charged, the daily rate, taxes, fees, and method of payment. Any receipts missing this information will result to us in reaching out for additional documentation, thus unfortunately slowing down the process of reimbursing the traveler. So please make sure this information is in the report. Ride shares like Lyft and Uber expenses are reimbursable per policy. Taxis are also reimbursable. Add-ons such as XL, Lux, or any other upgrades which might be considered lavish in nature are not reimbursable. It is also helpful for us auditors if ride shares have its own expense line or itemized expense line. When all the ride shares are added up as a lump sum expense line, it requires us to verify the expenses, increases the margin of error, which would result in the report being returned to adjust the ride share amount. A good number of return reports occur when multiple expenses are calculated in one expense line and do not match the receipts. Private car services. These services are generally not reimbursable unless it is proven to be the most economical means of transportation. Rideshare comparisons should be provided if it appears that the car service is lavish in nature. A detailed business purpose and receipt is required whenever a private car service is used. Now I'm going to go over when receipts are required. The original of the following receipts must be submitted with the travel expense claim. It must include the traveler's name, date, and method of payment. These are airline expenses, lodging expenses incurred for domestic travel, all rental car expenses, expenses exceeding $75, receipts for gifts provided to a host costing $25 or more, or conferences, registrations, or seminar fees. Electronic receipts are acceptable provided that the details match what would have been provided in the original paper receipt. For example, an electronic receipt must show the name of the payee, the amount charged, the transaction date, and the form of payment. Per diem is the daily amount to cover meals for UCSD employees traveling on official university business. Per diem applies to the following travel situations: foreign travel, Alaska, Hawaii, or U.S. possessions such as Guam, long-term travel, 30 days or more in the continental United States. Per diem is not the same as meals and incidental expenses, which applies to short-term travel, 29 days or fewer, in the continental U.S. only. The incidental portions of a per diem includes tips for services and costs for ground transportation directly connected with a meal. For example, a taxi from a hotel to a restaurant and back. Concur has a useful tool built in called the per diem allowance feature, which automatically calculates per diem based on your location. We've included a KBA hyperlink for how to use the per diem allowance feature. This feature eliminates the need to create individual expense lines for the meals and lodging, saving the report preparer time. Use Concur to determine per diem maximums, which are automatically calculated based on the location and duration. Travelers should only claim actual travel expenses up to the per diem rate. If travelers exceed the maximum per diem rate for lodging and/or meals, a valid business purpose is required and receipts must be attached. For each meal or lodging provided at no charge during travel or paid as part of a registration fee, the daily per diem must be adjusted. If actual expenses exceed the per diem rate, receipts are required. Examples include: the traveler is required to attend a meeting or conference where meals and lodging were being obtained at a prearranged place, and the lodging consumes all or most of the per diem allowance. The traveler is going to an area where lodging and meal costs have temporarily increased because of a special event or function, for example, a national or international sports camp or event. Affordable lodging is not available within reasonable commuting distance, or the cost of commuting consumes the savings from occupying the less expensive lodging. If the reasons for requesting reimbursement for actual lodging and meal expenses in lieu of per diem is not listed above, contact UC San Diego Travel via service and support prior to requesting reimbursement for the trip. Use Concur to request reimbursement for official business travel. For guidance, see the knowledge-based article that we have hyperlinked in the presentation. Reimbursement for actual reimbursement for actual expenses for meals and lodging cannot exceed 300% of the maximum per diem established for that location. Please note that the travel allowance feature cannot be used if the traveler is using his or her T&E card, in which case the per diem rates from the State Department will need to be attached to the report. We've included a link below to find these rates. It is hyperlinked in the presentation and will be sent out. So now we're going to quickly review what we discussed during our presentation. Be sure to have a valid and detailed business purpose for the university travel. If detailed business purposes are not provided, we will reach out, which could potentially delay reimbursement to the traveler. Also, be sure that travelers are booking the most economical means of transportation for air and ground. It may make financial sense to use the rental car or personal car mileage. Just keep in mind the costs associated with ground transportation. Be mindful of daily meal and lodging caps and per diem rates for foreign travel or domestic travel over 30 days. Encourage all travelers to apply for the T&E card. A good tip is sometimes meals post the next day, which could make the day appear to be over the $62 limit. Make sure to note that in the expense line if it occurs to avoid the report being sent back. We would briefly like to highlight the Concur mobile app. The Concur mobile app is a great tool to manage and track your business expenses on the go. With this app, you can book airfare, hotels, and more. Check flight statuses, change/cancel your reservations, view the T&E and CTS card transactions, and add them to the expense reports. You can capture receipts with your camera phone, submit and approve travel requests and expense reports. For more information, there is, when you log into Concur, it will be on the main screen. Some good practices we like to see in expense reports are clear, legible documents that support airfare, lodging, rental cars, and expenses exceeding $75. Sometimes we receive blurry or faded documents, which we will usually have to reach out. We like to see airfare booked through Concur using the CTS or T&E card. Select local lodging for guest travelers is also available using the CTS card, which is the card on file with the university. Expenses should also be entered separately, especially for meals and ride shares, to avoid miscalculations and return reports. It now goes to the end of our presentation. I can see we have a number of questions in the chat. We will now review them in the order that they were received. Please unmute if you have any follow-ups after your questions have been addressed. Due to other classes being offered, we do have a hard stop time at, let me look real quickly, 12:30. So we will now review the questions in the chat and order them, respond to them in the way they were received. If you have any follow-up to our responses, just unmute and let us know, and we'll follow up with you. If for some reason we can't get to your question by 12:30, we will follow up in an email to you. Okay. So our first question is from Ivana. When we attend a conference and the event organizer has a better hotel negotiated rate and provide a link to book the hotel, can we use the link provided by the event organizer? Yes, as long that is acceptable. You can use the T&E card. That's the preferred way. You can pay out of pocket, but you won't be reimbursed until after the trip has concluded. So yes, that is allowable. And then our next question is from Sarah. How do you know when a trip request is approved? I'm currently told to use the trip request number to book travels, but that generates as soon as I submit the request. The trip request is just pre-authorization. My department, we don't deal with the trip request approval process. That is usually on the department side. Once it clears the department's levels of approval, then you should be able to get that trip ID needed.
So when I go into Concur and I put the request in, it automatically gives me that request number. Mm-hmm. And I'm told just to use that to book trips, but how do I know that that's been approved? Because clearly it hasn't gone through the approval process yet.
You can look at the workflow. So in the actual like expense, you can see you or the request, you can look at the workflow to make to see if it's gone through all the approvers. And then that it's just a pre-authorization. So that amount can change when you're going, even when you're going to reconcile. So yeah, as long as it's just approved by your department in the end, it's fine to start booking travel with that ID.
Okay. All right. So you just have to go into Concur and look at the workflow. Like you won't be sent an email or anything like Oracle does saying that it's been approved.
I believe that the system does generate an email when it's approved. If you're like me, I have a lot of rules in my emails so that I don't keep getting Concur's, you know, millions of emails that it likes to send out through the system. Yeah. So I would just double check like maybe your spam or if you do have any rules, then just to see if it's been approved. But you can also go and look up the request and it should say if it's approved or not.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, our next question is from Karen. What is the minimum amount of miles what a traveler can submit for mileage reimbursement? Karen, there really isn't a minimum. I've actually approved reports for $10, which, you know, seems a little bit ridiculous, but if they are occurring an out-of-pocket expense, I mean, it is reimbursable. There's no limits. And just let me know if you have any follow-ups to that.
Thank you. No, that's pretty much it. Thank you.
Okay, our next question is from Diana. If groceries are purchased for a 3-day travel period on day one, is that still limited by the $62 daily maximum, even though groceries will be used for over 3 days? The total amount of the groceries can be divided by the 3 days. And as long as those, if there was any other meals incurred on those 3 days, as long as it doesn't exceed $62 on any given day, that'll be fine. We just have to have the detailed notes in the expense line that the total amount for the groceries on day one is for XYZ dates. So yeah, that's fine. As long as it doesn't exceed if there's other meal incidentals. Just, you know, if you have a follow up with that. Okay, and then from Marina, what is the threshold for a layover? Marina, are you speaking in regards to like for an upgrade? Like if there was like for the exception to policy for an upgrade to air class? Well, so if it was for an upgrade to like business class because of an exceedingly long layover, it's usually when it's an overnight layover and it requires a hotel. So then if that's the only way in economy, then that would, but there's another way to get there more directly through business class that is acceptable, except we just have to have documentation about that. And then that would be an exception to policy. Okay, our next question is from Olivia. What are the best practices to get comparable airfare? Yes, we all know that this is a very difficult thing to do because we can't go back in time and pull comparables. So what we recommend is that you search for future dates, try to avoid any major holidays, and then take into account when the original flight was booked, like the duration between when it was booked and when the flight actually took place. So then you'll just search for future.
Real quick, you mentioned like the holiday thing, like for my example, you know, travel was booked in like 4th of July holiday. So I mean, does that not matter? You know, I should just pick like an August or I guess at this point, a September date that's similar. Is that what you're saying?
So the traveler, he went for business trip during like an actual holiday?
Yeah, kind of like it was like the 4th of July weekend where he came out to do research work, for example.
Then you might actually want to look for a September date, maybe around Labor Day, like what it would have been like around the 4th of July holiday.
Okay, I got it, thank you.
Yeah, that one's a little tricky because the actual travel took place during a holiday season or a holiday period. So if that happens, then I would probably try to suggest look around holiday times.
Yeah, and I think this kind of leads into the next question of like the hotel prices being, you know, higher as well, like during the holiday season. So
yeah, mm-hmm, definitely. And so, yeah, from Libby, she asks, is there any plan to make the 275 night limit based on location of travel? Many conferences take place in destination locations, high tourist season, even discounted rates exceed that amount. We understand it. It is a low rate, especially with the rising costs of everything right now. As long as it's written in the expense line, and if it does not exceed the 275 by that much, then we wouldn't reach out for comparisons. But if it exceeds it, like we're talking maybe into like the 390 and above for a daily, for a nightly rate, and that's when we would want to get some comparables of what local hotels are also are going for as well. And to my knowledge, unfortunately, I don't believe that there is any conversation for having it based on the location. The 275 a night is established for continental travel. Wish we could. That's up to UCOP. And then Libby, if you have any follow-up, just let me know.
Sure. So I guess my follow-up question is, who at UCSD gives advice to UCOP, and is it possible to do any pushing on that?
Our managers have been pushing UCOP for a very long time, especially with the $62 cap too for meals. That we know that's ridiculous. We tell them this, so we're trying to get more movement on it. Soon, but it's definitely a conversation that IPPS upper management's been having with UCOP. So, well, hang in there. We'll try to get it worked out. And then, the Bay Area is very expensive from Charlotte. So, yeah, if it exceeds an exorbitant amount, then we would just require comparisons for the hotels, for other local hotels. All right. Our next question is, does mileage contributions apply to errand runs on behalf of your job duties, picking up supplies or equipment for events? Yes, mileage can be claimed for those. If it's anything where you have to use your personal car to do university business, like picking up supplies, and perhaps your department doesn't have access to vehicles or whatnot, UC vehicles, then yes, mileage is definitely reimbursable for that. Our next question is from Maria. Driving to from a local conference, not on campus, by employee mileage is covered. Yes, mileage is covered to a local conference. Another question from Libby. Our department policy requires us to claim actual meal expenses on foreign travel. So being required to use the per diem allowance tool to get the total down to what the traveler is claiming for actual expenses results in really messy expense reports and confuses travelers. Is there any way to claim actual meal expenses that are below the per diem so that we don't have to play checkbox bingo? Yeah, the per diem allowance feature, it is designed to help the report preparer. We really try to encourage people to use the per diem allowance feature. It avoids you having to enter in individual expense lines for every single meal and for all the lodging. So to claim actuals, it's actually very easy. There's an expense line called per diem offset. And the difference between the posted per diem and then the actual expenses would be captured there. So it would just capture the difference in one lump sum, and you don't have to split it out over all the days. So you would just, the allowance feature can be used, and then claiming actuals, you can just add them up into one expense line. Because we know how cumbersome it can get with our travelers international traveling. So yeah, it's designed to be a helpful tool, hopefully. Let's see. Our next question is, do we not need receipts for any charges under 75? No, there are receipts that are required regardless of the 75, and that was airfare, lodging, rental car, and conference registration. So regardless of the 75, those are still required. Okay, and our next question is from Carissa. Is there any way to add additional COVID-19 insurance for foreign travel so we don't have to quarantine in foreign countries after work slash events in the event of a positive diagnosis? The UCSD travel insurance does not cover any evacuations, removal from foreign countries. Unfortunately, we can't really speak to additional insurance for COVID. Risk management would definitely be your best resource for that. We do cover travel expenses if the traveler has to quarantine. If they, let's say, they got COVID on business travel, we would cover those expenses. But as far as the insurance goes, we can't really speak to that, especially for foreign travel. But risk management will be your best contact. And our next question is from Natalie. I am trying the Concur app and it doesn't allow me to sign in after selecting my identity provider. Is there another way to sign in on my iPhone? When you log in to Concur, I think if you sign on through you have to sign on through single sign-on. And then I think that sends you a link on how to set it up. Unfortunately, our Travel Ops, which is Josh and I are from Travel Ops, we're not too familiar with how to create a profile on Concur or Concur Mobile, but we know that it's a helpful tool. We just want to extend knowledge. Wish I could be a little bit more help with that one. Our next question is from Thornton. If a faculty has an approved trip request but ends up not attending a conference, can they still be reimbursed for their registration fee? Is it a non-reimbursable fee, Thornton?
Yes, it's non-reimbursable.
Yeah, that's fine. You can just create an expense report and then just put detailed notes that the conference registration fee was not reimbursable.
Perfect.
Yeah, so you should be good to go on that one.
Thank you.
Okay. Stacy says, yes, you do get an approval. Yeah, so that was in regards to our first question about getting emails for travel requests. You should be getting an email. So I would definitely try to check to see if it's going to spam or if you have any rules set up in your email, because I definitely have a lot of rules set up in my email so I don't get every single Concur auto email. Let's see. How long does it take for the commitment to be lifted once the trip has been reconciled and the expense posted in Oracle? Unfortunately, my team really can't speak to commitments. I believe the Oracle team might have to submit a service and support case for this one. We do know that once we approve an expense report, it takes 3 to 4 business days for it to be paid out. But unfortunately, I'm not too sure about commitments. Let's see. Next question is from Jen. A traveler took a foreign trip of 30 days or more. He is not seeking reimbursement for airfare or lodging because he's covering them with airfare or lodging points. Does he need to provide meal receipts or can he use the per diem, the meal per diem rate? Yeah, Jen, so he can actually use the per diem allowance tool. It doesn't have to be for both meals and lodging. So you can use the meal allowance feature for the per diem. And then if he's claiming actuals, then like I said, you can use the per diem reduction so that it reduces the amount to what was actually spent. So it will avoid you having to enter in individual expense lines for all those meals. So as long as they're not exceeding the per diem, then he shouldn't have to provide receipts and he's using the per diem allowance feature. All right. Okay, if you go over $62 meal maximums, is there an opportunity for your department head to override or allow it, or are you responsible for the overages no matter what? Yeah, unfortunately, like we were mentioning, this is one of those very hard line. We cannot exceed the $62 for continental travel. I've heard rumors, and these are just rumors, that UCOP is thinking is going to raise that, but we don't have anything concrete yet. So until that happens, yeah, it's still at $62. When filing the actual expenses on the travel allowance, besides uploading the Excel sheet, we still need to upload hotel and meal invoices. For foreign travel, if you're using the per diem allowance feature, we do not require receipts. Our next question is from Giselle. I'm not given the option to create travel allowance when using the out-of-state continental US option in Concur. Is there a reason behind this? Giselle, do you have multiple expense reports trying to use the per diem allowance feature?
Yes, but also when I'm doing an individual expense report, if I choose the out-of-state continental US option, it doesn't let me do travel allowance.
Okay, it may be because that unfortunately you can't have multiple expense reports that are using the per diem allowance feature at the same time. So I think that may be the reason why it's doing that. Like if there's multiple expense reports that have the per diem allowance feature being used during the same dates, it won't allow you to do multiples.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so unfortunately what you're gonna have to do in that circumstance, and this is for everyone, if you have, let's say you have a bunch of guest travelers and you're trying to use the per diem allowance feature, you'll only be allowed to use it for one of them. Unfortunately, with the system limitations, if it's in the same dates, it won't allow you to use the per diem allowance feature for everyone with the same dates. So in which case you would have to enter it in individually and then just attach the per diem rates.
If she's not Oconus and under 30 days, then she can't do per diem, right?
No, per diem doesn't apply for
because she's just talking about out of state.
Oh, out of state. Okay. I see. Yeah. You would claim per diem if the travel was for 30 days or more. That's the only time that you claim per diem in the continental United States.
Oh, okay. Thank you. That makes sense.
Yeah. So that's definitely probably why you're not seeing the per diem allowance feature if it's less than 30 days. And Suzette comments, she thinks that commitments are dropped off after closing the request, after travel and reconciliations are complete. Hopefully that's the case.
I'm going to drop a blank page right now in the chat for commitments.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Next question, are there any recommended practices for submitting a travel request after the trip already took place? It's preferably not. We'd preferably rather have the request created before the travel expense before the travel took place. But we know circumstances. We know sometimes you get professors that travel and then they just tell you afterwards. So you can create the travel request, and it will after the fact. It's just a pre-authorization, and then once that's created, you'll be able to create the expense report to reconcile the charges. But yeah, we do ask that travel requests are created before the trip, but we understand there's circumstances for it. It might not happen.
Thank you. Okay.
Yep, no problem. It looks like, unfortunately, we are at time. I will copy the questions that we did not get to. And you will be receiving an email for individual. We'll email you individually. So thank you everybody for joining us at this session. We have a lot of good questions. Please be sure to check out our other courses, and have a great day, everyone.